the last days of November, 1950, 12,000 men of the 1st Marine Division, along with a few thousand Army soldiers, found themselves trapped high in the mountains of North Korea near a reservoir called Chosun. Their leaders had been caught off guard by the sudden entrance of the People's Republic of China into the five-month-old Korean War. The Americans were surrounded, outnumbered, and at risk of annihilation. The two-week battle that followed is among the most momentous in U.S. history. It helped set the course of American foreign policy in the Cold War and beyond, and it remains one of the most renowned in Marine Corps annals.
I think all battles are terrible, but this one might well have been the very worst in American history. These were some of the harshest winter conditions that American forces have ever fought in.
You were not only physically frozen, you were emotionally frozen. Not knowing how much more you could give, and yet wanting to survive.
The hardest thing I ever did in my life was pick up the frozen bodies of the Marines that had been killed, and their arms and legs were bent in the position in which they'd been killed.
I wrote a letter home to your mom and dad. By the time you get this letter, you know the Marine Corps has been annihilated, or we're coming out of here with some pretty good odds.
The Marines marched up into those mountains, and when they marched out of those mountains, they were different, the war was different, America was different, and really the entire world was different.
Exclusive corporate funding for American Experience is provided by Liberty Mutual Insurance.
The American Road Trip. Still one of the best ways to see the country. Giving you the freedom to go where you want, stop where you please, and make as many memories as you possibly can. For over 100 years, we've built auto coverage to help Americans enjoy their journeys. Liberty Mutual Insurance is a proud sponsor of American Experience.
Major funding for American Experience is provided by
the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, supporting original research and public understanding of science, technology, and economics.
American Experience is also made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
On Thanksgiving Day, 1950, American-led United Nations troops were on the march in North Korea. The forces of democracy, according to the New York Times, were brushing away scant resistance. What remained of North Korea's Communist Army had apparently turned and fled. U.S. Marine and Air Force pilots owned the skies and proved it by distributing holiday bounty up and down the peninsula. Even to the men at the tip of the spear, near the northern border of Korea, within sight of China.
They made a monumental effort to put that kind of meal out under those conditions, and it was wonderful. Turkey, mincemeat pie, pumpkin pie, cranberries, the whole works.
It was cold turkey, let me tell you. The cooks did the best they could, but it was Thanksgiving, and we did have optimism that the war would be over, and maybe that's thanks in itself.
The commander of the UN forces, General Douglas MacArthur, flew into Korea the next day to launch the final offensive of what was shaping up to be a short and successful war.
MacArthur tells the troops and his commanders that the fundamental goal of the Korean War, to unify the peninsula under the control of the South Korean government, will soon be accomplished. And he says to the soldiers, I hope you boys will be home by Christmas.
The northern boundary of North Korea is the Yalu River. And so his cry became that he wanted to go to the Yalu and conquer all of North Korea. They were just going to go up the mountain, just like cutting through butter, and they were going to go to the Yalu, and it was going to be great.
I was really excited about it. I thought, boy, this is what we should do. And I thought that, you know, it was in the bag. I thought we were going to pull it off.
Everything was just wide open. Let's do it.
Routine at that point. We had won the war. It was over. It was that blunt.
5 months into the Korean War, American troops and commanders had reason for confidence. Split across the middle at the 38th parallel in the political settlement that followed World War II, the Korean Peninsula had solidified into two separate states by 1950. North Korea had the support of the Soviet Union and of Mao Zedong's new communist China. The United States and other Western democracies backed the South. This uneasy balance held until June 25, 1950. The North Korean army blasted through the 38th parallel that day, scattering South Korean defenses. It captured Seoul, the capital of the South, in less than 72 hours and kept going, making plain its goal to take the entire peninsula.
When the North Koreans invaded, they had Soviet equipment, they had Soviet tanks, they had Soviet advisors. The American people believed that what was happening is that it was Stalin's proxy war against the United States.
On hearing the grave news, President Truman flies to Washington from his Missouri home. The president described the invasion as a threat to the peace which cannot be tolerated.
This is a direct challenge to the efforts of free nations to build the kind of world in which men can live in freedom and peace. This challenge has been presented squarely. We must meet it squarely.
Within days of the invasion, the United Nations Security Council resolved to repel the North Koreans from the South and to restore peace and security in the area. The United States was to lead a multinational force tasked with enforcing the UN resolution.
I was 20 years old when the war broke out. I knew very little about Korea, but I knew we were in direct conflict with the Soviet Union and that the Soviets were out to spread communism worldwide. I knew that.
They activated all of the Marine reserves at that time because they needed troops now, like right now.
I just wanted to be a Marine in the worst way. I was too young for World War II. There were at least 2,000 of us, all the same thing. We were kids just out of high school and all wanted to be a Marine. A gung-ho Marine, carry a rifle, shoot at somebody.
I remember getting on the train and we pulled out. I remember my mother waving to us. But then later on I realized that she really wasn't waving. She was giving us her blessing as we drove by.
By the time the first big wave of reserves arrived, the North Korean army had nearly pushed U.S. troops off the peninsula. But Douglas MacArthur remained confident he could reverse the losses. He ordered his forces to attack deep into enemy-held territory at the port of Incheon.
MacArthur took the chance and tried to conduct a landing there at high tide, which only had a range of a few hours to debark troops there. And also, it wasn't a good beach at all. There's a seawall there. But the enemy didn't expect us to land there. So it became a tremendous surprise to the enemy. And it wasn't very well defended. Success at Incheon was a bold stroke of genius.
On 16 September, the 1st Marine Division moves through Incheon. This city is recaptured against relatively light resistance. Allied casualties are few. As these men move through Incheon, their objective is Seoul.
The success at Incheon changed everything. The North Korean supply line was cut. There was a direct route from Incheon into Seoul, which is the capital, and taking it was not only a military victory, but also a psychological one and a political one as well.
The goal begins to change now, because what MacArthur first thought was, well, we'll just disintegrate the North Korean army and we'll reestablish the borders. But then he begins to realize, maybe I can pursue the North Koreans into their own country, into North Korea, and destroy the last remnants of that army. It becomes this idea of taking the entire country. And it's not just MacArthur, it's really all the leaders in Washington. There's a glimpse of total victory.
President Harry Truman had a major reservation. He was worried that Communist China might enter the war to defend the North Korean regime. His general waved it off.
MacArthur was very disdainful of the Chinese as a fighting force. They were a peasant army, they weren't very well armed, they didn't have an air force to speak of. He really was quite scornful of this notion that the Chinese posed a threat.
MacArthur's instructions from his bosses at the Joint Chiefs of Staff were to proceed with caution in North Korea. Only soldiers from South Korea would be allowed to fight all the way to the Chinese border. But MacArthur believed he knew best. 3 days after his men captured the North Korean capital of Pyongyang, the general directed his commanders to speed forward, using all available forces.
The troops became even more jubilant because here we not only repulsed an enemy who was aggressive, we taught him a lesson. Now we're taking his territory. The word of optimism went around. We'll rout these North Koreans completely, and we'll go all the way to the Yalu.
By the last week in November, MacArthur had the Yalu in his sights, and he had a plan to get there. His armies on either side of the Taebaek Mountains would act as armored pincers. They would close the divide between them, form a solid front, and then race north before the long and brutal Korean winter settled in. This should, for all practical purposes, end the war, MacArthur told the press, and restore peace and unity to Korea.
I didn't know what the orders were. All I knew is we were moving out. It was about 7 miles uphill to where we were going.
We advanced rather slowly because that's about the only way you could walk up there. You had two directions to go up in North Korea, and that was either straight up or straight down because it was a very mountainous, very rugged terrain.
It was real hazardous for us because that main supply route was an ox trail. That's all it was. Oftentimes, it's just one lane wide along a side hill cut with a big bank on one side and then a plunging cliff on the other.
We finally got into a village called Udamni, and it was just the most desolate country you ever wanted to see. A pile of boulders and rocks, and of course snow and wind. Everybody was grumbling and crabbing. But that's the Marine Corps. If you're not crabbing, you ain't a Marine.
The temperatures were plunging at night to as much as 25 below zero. And the northwest wind was blowing 15, 20 miles an hour out of Manchuria. But still, We were cheered up, thinking with optimism, well, we won't have to endure this for long. Maybe they're right. Maybe the war will be over.
MacArthur's willingness to sacrifice caution for speed had consequences. On the eve of its final offensive, the 1st Marine Division was strung out on a single supply route, nearly 80 miles long, leading to the Chosin Reservoir. 3,600 men were making camp at the bottom of the reservoir at Hagaruri, where division headquarters and a much-needed airfield were taking shape. 5 miles ahead, on the west side of the reservoir, was a small contingent of 400 Marines, defending the high ground above the road. The bulk of the forces, 8,000 Marines, were digging in near the village of Udamni, preparing to spearhead the next day's offensive. To the east were 2,500 U.S. Army soldiers and several hundred South Korean fighters, placed there to protect the right flank of the attacking Marines. As darkness fell on November 27th, the men on both sides of the reservoir were settling in for their last night of sleep before their big attack to the Yalu.
There was one tree up in that hill, a fully grown tree with pine branches. And I took my entrenching tool and knocked some of those branches off, and I laid it down, put my sleeping bag on top, and I was going to get a good night's rest. And I heard bang, bang, bang.
Flares, like a bugle blowing, whistles, clangs, screaming, and illumination flares being shot up. And all you could see ahead of us was Chinese coming at us. A lot of them. You know, so we set up our fields of fire and defense positions, braced for the attack.
The first sergeant was screaming for everybody out. Get out of our tents and get on the ground and get your rifles out, because they're coming.
All of a sudden, here come a whole bunch of Chinese. They were in these quilted uniforms, coming down inside our perimeter, down the valley toward us. I shot one nearest me, and he just staggered. I had to shoot him twice before he went down.
Some Chinese communist jumps up about 10 yards out in front, and somebody yelled, "Duck, he's got a grenade."
It's terrifying. You know you're going to die, and you wonder how it's going to happen.
We used everything we had, our M1s, carbines, if you could get it to work. We had a machine gun, and it was just one solid field of fire as they come down. You didn't have to look where they were. They went back here, in front of you, around you, right in the middle of you.
You'd be shooting, you'd be stabbing. You're using your rifle as a club. Sometimes it'd be 6-8 feet away from you before you even knew it. And that's when either the bayonet or your rifle become a club.
When things got hot and heavy, my good friend Sergeant Bob Devins got a burp gun right through the back of his head. We tried to keep him alive, but we had nothing to work with. I took my t-shirt out of my backpack, I had an extra one, and I tried to stop the blood with that, but he bled to death. We were just hanging by a thread.
When the attack subsided the next morning, one of MacArthur's most trusted subordinates, General Ned Almond, choppered into the command post on the east side of the reservoir to buck up the badly shaken army unit. One of the highest-ranking officers on the ground, Lieutenant Colonel Donald Faith, was just then making sense of what had happened the night before.
Faith told him, and it should have been convincing, "General, we're in deep trouble. We captured Chinese soldiers from two different divisions. That indicates we've got two divisions right here in our vicinity. What are we doing, General? We just barely survived. We fended them off. But we need help." And General Allman, he said, "What do you mean? You're going to let a few Chinese laundrymen stop you? We're going to continue the attack."
The leader of the People's Republic of China, Mao Zedong, had won a long and deadly civil war a year earlier and united the country under his communist flag. But he was a man made wary by a lifetime of fighting. Chairman Mao was wary of his foes inside China. He was wary of the growing Soviet empire on his northern border. And he was especially wary of Americans who had backed his enemy in the Civil War and whose army was threatening his border in the fall of 1950.
What Mao had on his hands, and this is a reverse of what people thought in the U.S., people thought Mao was an evil, crazy communist dictator, and MacArthur was a great hero. But from Mao's standpoint, MacArthur was the irrational one. He just wanted to plunge ahead. What would the U.S. do if the Chinese Communist Army were marching up Mexico, talking about rolling back American capitalism in the Southwest?
Mao had begun preparations to enter the war in North Korea back in October, around the time MacArthur's troops first crossed the 38th parallel. When MacArthur's army kept pushing north, nearing the Chinese border, Mao set his battle plan in motion.
U.S. intelligence knew that there were troops that were being amassed in Manchuria, who just didn't know what they were doing there, right? And of course, what they were doing there was slowly and quietly infiltrating into North Korea.
The Chinese used the night cover to camouflage their movements, and they were moving away from the roads, hidden at night from our aircraft surveillance, and also in the daytime by staying within the forest under the trees.
They moved at night, and they stayed up on the ridgelines. The U.S. forces, in general, stayed on the roads and went hell-bent for the border. But meanwhile, in between the forces, Chinese were coming quietly down on foot.
Mao knew his military was far inferior to the Americans in tanks, artillery, and air power. But he had taken the measure of MacArthur and discerned a weakness. In early November, Mao sent small cadres of troops to attack all along the approaching American front. Then his men pulled back in what looked like a full retreat.
The Chinese hit hard. Then they just disappeared. There was nothing out there anymore. MacArthur said full speed ahead again.
This became part of the strategy, which is to lure the Americans further into North Korea, have them penetrate deeply, and then ultimately surround them. There's a certain shrewdness about Mao. He knows who he's dealing with. He knows that MacArthur is quite arrogant. This is a strategy that plays into that arrogance.
We had interrogated North Korean prisoners, North Korean civilians, and even a few Chinese. And what we learned from all these interrogations was that there are large amounts of Chinese army on the other side of the Yalu River, which is the border between North Korea and Manchuria. And we passed the word to division. Division passed it to Corps. Corps passed it to Army, which was MacArthur. And he disbelieved that. He said, "Nah, they're not going to come into Korea."
They couldn't seem to accept that, yes, the Chinese are coming down. Even when the first fingers touched us, it wasn't accepted that. This didn't mean anything. It was that sort of thing in the headquarters. Huh.
Mao lured American troops quite literally to the Yalu, and they were surrounded on all sides.
United Nations troops are obliged to fall back on all fronts in the face of attacks by Chinese Reds. This is the bitter fate of the Allied armies who almost had the independence of Korea a settled question. In Northeast Korea, the situation is even graver. Here, thousands of Marines and other United Nations forces are trapped.
The worst of the Chinese onslaught landed on the 1st Marine Division, then under the command of General Oliver P. Smith. Soft-spoken and cautious, Smith had doubted the wisdom of MacArthur's headlong march to the Chinese border. And now, the consequences of MacArthur's boldness were falling on Smith and his men.
He realizes that it's a completely different war now. The advance to the Yalu, as far as he's concerned, is over. He genuinely feared that the entire 1st Marine Division was in jeopardy, that it could be wiped out. His job now was to figure out a way out of this trap.
At least six Chinese divisions, some 60,000 troops, were on the attack against Smith's loosely consolidated 15,000. Smith understood that his own headquarters at the village of Hagaru was on critical ground. Hagaru had not yet been attacked, but Smith knew the Chinese were coming. The crossroads town had to be held if there was to be any hope of extracting his endangered men.
Hagaru was very thinly defended. There really weren't very many combat troops there at all. General Smith had cooks and bakers and PX people, and he had the engineers that were building the field. It was a really motley crew.
While American fighter planes kept the Chinese pinned down, Smith pushed his engineers to finish construction of the airstrip so pilots could fly in reinforcements. And he deployed almost every man at his disposal to defend the perimeter of Hagaru, many at a spot called East Hill, the high ground that rose above the ammunition dump.
Ammunition are coming, they just drop. Every hour they just drop and drop, drop. It was my job to get the supply by airdrops. The Chinese started to fire at us when we are picking up the supplies.
The vital airdrops ceased as darkness descended on Hagaru just before 5 o'clock on November 28th. The men dug in to hold East Hill could see the engineers at work under floodlights, racing to finish the airstrip below. A light snow began to fall at around 8 o'clock, and for the next few hours, all was quiet, but for the scrape and roar of the bulldozers. Just after 10:30, the calm broke.
The Chinese recognized the fact that East Hill was the key. So they really concentrated it that night. We were at the bottom to halfway up the hill, and not with infantry. We had engineers, artillerymen, cooks and bakers, whoever we could gather. You have to do it. You have to hold it.
You hear a mortar shell coming, and then boom, and then you'd hear a scream. Somebody had been hit. The Chinese were just coming and coming and coming, and we were scared.
It wasn't typical sorts of warfare that we had learned during our training as young Marines, that there would be enemy coming at us in these huge numbers with very little regard for their own safety.
The only way they could overwhelm us was with sheer force of numbers. First wave would all have weapons. The second wave wouldn't all have weapons. They would pick up weapons.
of the first wave. And the third wave would be commissars with burp guns. Nobody retreats.
Smith's men were hugely outnumbered. The Chinese divisions were coming in from all sides. Smith was really doubtful whether Hagaru could actually hold.
While the makeshift unit struggled to hold Hagaru, their fellow Marines west of the reservoir were preparing for a second night of attack.
I had no idea what was coming. I knew it'd be bad, and I hope I can do what I'm supposed to do and don't let anybody down.
You learn to control your emotions. You pledge yourself to fight for your buddy, and he has the same to fight for me. So he's not going to leave me there, and I'm not going to leave him there either.
You reached back and found out what you made of. It's not trying to be heroic and vain, but you are out there to do a job, and if you don't do it, it's not only going to get you killed, they're going to get your whole outfit killed.
They really came down on us. They overrun our position. Our machine guns were firing so hot and heavy they were burning the barrels out.
There were a few times that I actually had to take the damn machine gun and turn it all the way around and fire over the heads of our own men that were behind us because they were breaking through.
Now they're starting to move up the hill and we're shooting at them. And so now I'm firing, and people are starting to run through on the side of the rocks that way from us, maybe 5-10 yards that way. So my rifle jams now. And this guy throws a hand grenade over. I took one step and the hand grenade went off. I feel myself flying through the air, but I don't feel myself hit the ground.
I think it was a mortar that hit right in the hole, and I flew up out in the air and landed on the ground. And I looked around and I said, hey, them poor guys lost the leg. And I got up and I fell flat on my face. And I looked down and it was that leg laying over there, and that poor guy was me. It was my right leg was gone at the knee.
I prayed that night for the first time in my life. God, don't let me die. Not here, not this far from home. I just want to see the sun come up one more time. Just give me another day.
When the first light of morning rose, the Chinese retreated back to their daytime hiding spots. The Marines still held all of Hagaru, as well as the crucial hills around Yudanni. The cost had been dear.
I found this one Marine. He was on top of the hill. He was in a hole that I thought he was dead. Oh, he was nothing moving at all, but you could see his eyes moving. His face was all ash and gray, and we picked him up, and we carried and drug him all down the hill to the aid station.
They had fellows all over the floor on straw mats, on the blankets, and doing the best they could for him. The odds were against trying to save a guy. But yet, fellas that had gunshot wounds, I mean bad, bad gunshot wounds, it was so cold the blood froze. And these guys managed to survive. Guys without a leg from here down. It was so cold, everything congealed. And he managed to live. They'd lost their leg. They were still alive.
Everything was complicated by exposure to extreme cold. They had stopped bleeding because the area froze, and then we got them, we looked at them, and as they thawed, they started bleeding, and we discovered 4 or 5 additional bullet holes. You did the best you could do, and when you finished, you moved on to the next patient.
They tried to cover them with blankets or tents or anything else they could against the cold, but they'd still freeze to death.
That morning's after-battle reports were sobering. General O.P. Smith wasn't sure how much longer the men at Udemy could hold on. There was little word from the badly outnumbered army units on the east side of the reservoir. Even worse, the Chinese had now driven far south of Hagaru, cut the main supply road behind Smith, and attacked the 1st Marine garrison at Kodori, just 11 miles away. Hagaru was now menaced on 3 sides.
Smith was really worried that Hagaru was going to fall, and that the fighting at East Hill was reaching a critical point. He desperately needed reinforcements.
We needed more tanks, more infantry. We needed people to reinforce.
Just before 10 o'clock on the third morning of the battle, at Smith's order, 922 men left Kodori to reinforce Hagaru. Under the direction of British Lieutenant Colonel Douglas Drysdale, the task force comprised 235 British commandos, with a few attached American units, 141 supply vehicles, and 29 tanks.
Smith felt that if Drysdale didn't make it, Hagaru would not hold, and that would lead to the destruction of the entire division. The Chinese knew what was going on, and they did not want to let those guys through.
It started out well, but it took time. And then we ran into a lot of machine gun mortar, heavy mortar fire, and we got bogged down. We got wounded and dead Marines you're putting on trucks. Trucks are being blowed up, they're being shot up. As each truck stopped, the men on that truck had to protect that truck. That was their war. You didn't know what was happening, 2 trucks in front of you or 2 trucks behind you.
The Chinese cut off and destroyed the middle of Drysdale's convoy. The men at the rear turned and fought their way back to Kodori. Drysdale radioed Smith to report the unfolding disaster.
When Drysdale called General Smith, he wanted to know if he should turn around and go back to Kodori. General Smith knew that he had to have these reinforcements. He told him to come ahead at all costs. I told my assistant gunner, "This doesn't look good, Joe."
They were 10 hours behind schedule, and a little less than half the men remained. But Task Force Drysdale, including 16 of his 29 tanks, did manage to straggle into Hagaru. To the slender infantry garrison were added a tank company and some 300 seasoned infantry, a much relieved O.P. Smith noted. He now had the forces to hold the crucial ground around East Hill.
They said, put your men over here in this field and get some sleep. You couldn't build fires. We couldn't dig foxholes. Everything was frozen like a rock. There was some dead Chinese bodies laying around. So we stacked some of them up and to keep the wind off of us.
The condition of the army unit in the mountains east of the reservoir was still largely unknown. General Smith's headquarters had lost contact with the commander now in charge, Lieutenant Colonel Donald Faith. The men down on the ground were growing anxious.
The Chinese forces were increasing all the time. We had a throng around us. It looked like an entire division or a division and a half.
We were running out of ammunition. We were running out of gasoline for the vehicles. We hadn't had any food, really, for a couple days. The planes came in and dropped the wrong supplies to us. 40-millimeter rounds for 50-caliber machine guns. We were running out of everything, including people. And we knew it.
Somebody was prompting us that, well, the tanks are trying to break through to you. And well, after a couple of days of this, say, well, we've heard that one before. Because if we're gonna hear them before we ever see them, because they make so much noise, and we don't hear anything.
Faith's men were starting to lose all hope when a helicopter carrying the Army's divisional commander flew into their shrinking perimeter.
We exhilarated for a moment because we thought help was on its way. Here was our division commander. He was showing concern. Here he was. That means help must be on its way. But that wasn't the message.
The general said, you're going to get no help. We had to fight our own way out.
By the time General Douglas MacArthur left his headquarters in Tokyo to reckon the damage, he appeared to have lost his characteristic self-confidence.
It must have just shaken him right down to the ground to have this happen. It just was not in his game plan. I don't think he could understand it.
The Chinese had redrawn the battle map in less than 72 hours. MacArthur's army in the west of Korea was in headlong retreat, having abandoned supplies and weapons to Mao's forces. His 1st Marine Division at the Chosin Reservoir, outnumbered in some places by more than 10 to 1, was threatened with extinction.
MacArthur came over. I was there. I watched him get out of the airplane. He was a distraught individual at that point. He had been winning a war. It was over. And all of a sudden, he was losing it. He was, to me, at that moment, a damaged and distraught old man.
Every newspaper and every magazine was just full of the news. My wife didn't know anything about the details of it, but the headlines were big and broad. 31st Infantry annihilated.
My father kept a collection of newspaper clippings and his stories that the Marine Corps has been annihilated. It's a lost legion. Marine Corps trapped. They're isolated. The papers had given up on us.
My wife had lost a brother aboard the USS Arizona at Pearl Harbor. And she was thinking that I might she might lose me.
My grandmother would have been listening on the radio, and one of the famous broadcasters of the time said, if anyone has a son or a husband in the 1st Marine Division, pray for them. They may be lost.
President Harry Truman's national security advisors had been struggling to adjust themselves to a new reality in the days since Mao's spectacular attack. They admitted among themselves that the United States lacked the resources to defeat the Chinese in a protracted war in Korea. The best they could hope for was to draw a line somewhere on the peninsula, shore it up, hand it over to the South Koreans, and get out with some measure of honor intact. But top officials at the Pentagon weren't sure they had enough troops to hold any line. Press reports filled with talk of World War III and of the Soviet Union rolling into Western Europe while the U.S. was distracted in Asia. Truman even hinted he was willing to unleash the atomic bomb in defense of South Korea.
If aggression is successful in Korea, we can expect it to spread throughout Asia and Europe and to this hemisphere. We are fighting in Korea for our own national security and survival.
No one really seems to have the answer. But Truman is very clear that he is not going to give up Korea. This is a tremendously significant moment in American history. The talk is that our very civilization is on the line here.
The U.S. commanders on the ground in Korea got little direction from Washington. The Pentagon did give them leave to abandon Northeast Korea and to get the 1st Marines out to safety. But this was no simple mission. General Smith's men would have to make their way from the top of the Chosin Reservoir, through Hagaru, Kotori, and all the way to the Sea of Japan, 78 miles into the teeth of the subarctic winter, through tens of thousands of Chinese soldiers waiting in the high ground above the single road out.
Military historians have always said that a fighting withdrawal is the most difficult maneuver to pull off successfully. Everything has to be perfectly timed with close air support, with artillery, with getting the casualties out at the right moment. It's a very, very complex operation.
The division was getting geared up. They were burning a lot of things. They were getting rid of a lot of weapons, things that weren't usable, and we were going to start our way back south.
On December 1st, after 4 long nights of fighting off enemy attacks, the 1st Marines on the west side of the reservoir began their perilous journey.
You only had one road, one point of entry and egress on each side of the reservoir and up to the reservoir. Dirt road, flanked by hills on either side. A nightmare, absolute nightmare.
Mao thought that if he could destroy the 1st Marine Division, this would create great fear and doubt in Washington and cause the war to end quickly. His goal was not just to punish 1st Marine Division or damage them, but to completely annihilate them.
The regimental train was on the road, and the rifle companies were up in the hills doing the fighting. And we were moving south. There was firing going on up in the mountains all the time.
We were going up hills and down hills because the enemy was all around us, and you could hear firefights going on all over the place.
We were taking the high ground along the way to try to cover the road wherever possible. And we were going up this hill, and the guy next to me,
was from Alabama. The shell went off between him and I. And as it knocked me around and down, but as I spun around, he was falling. He had his head up like that, and the blood was just gushy. It looked like his whole face had torn off.
The 1st Marines had only one clear advantage in their fight south. The United States still controlled the skies. Air Force and Marine pilots from nearby Yanpo Airfield and Navy pilots from carriers in the Sea of Japan were quick to answer calls from spotters on the ground.
Our job was just to try to keep the numbers down so the Chinese wouldn't completely overrun the Marines just by sheer numbers. We had multiple missions almost every day. You really had to be on your toes. Mountain peaks were all over the place. Plus the fact that we had some very bad weather.
If the sun came out, it brought the planes. No sun, no planes. And when there was no planes, the Chinese were all over us.
That's the big thing about this Chosin Reservoir operation. We did so much close air support. And close is really close.
Occasionally, they were so low that you could actually see the face of the pilot through the cockpit window, you know, the glass. It's amazing the courage those guys had coming down like that. The serious stuff that we saw was napalm. That's a jelly gasoline.
Napalm was a new device. It is very potent stuff. When that explodes, it covers a big area. And it can do a tremendous amount of damage.
You walked through an area where the napalm had hit the enemy and their bodies were burned. The skin split and you could see the yellow fat. And there were smells that to this day I can't get rid of.
The army units east of the Chosin Reservoir were still feeling forsaken. They were holding out against a force of Chinese that outnumbered them by as much as 10-1. The dead and wounded were increasing day and night. Supplies dwindled. And there had been no word from General Smith in Hagaru.
Lieutenant Colonel Faith, he said, well, I've got all these wounded, and I've got no orders to withdraw. So he makes up his mind, we're going to pull out of there. We're going to try to make a run for it and go back to Hagaru.
We knew that our tank company had been at Hudong Ni, and we'd hoped maybe if we could join up with the tanks with their firepower, that then we would be escorted in safely to the Marines' Hagaru.
Once we get back to the tank, we got it made. We're home free. We got supplies back there and everything.
We had 400 to 450 wounded that had to be carried by truck. And the only way we could load them was to triple deck them. We stacked layers of wounded in the trucks.
The dead, you had to leave. You had to stack them on a pile. We had to leave them.
We had to strip the dead of their clothing in order to provide some warmth for those wounded on the trucks. We also went through the clothes looking for ammunition. We were so short of ammunition. It was grotesque, it really was. Horrible. Nightmare.
At 1 o'clock on the afternoon of December 1st, Faith's soldiers started the attack south. They were cheered at first to hear the roar of fighter planes overhead.
Marine aircraft came in to napalm the Chinese on the road in front of our advancing column. But one of them had a malfunction. It was dropped too early. And it was dropped on our advancing troops.
There was this blast of fire, and a lot of the guys that were in front of it didn't get back up.
Our troops were diverted trying to put out the flames of soldiers on fire. It was disconcerting, to say the least.
We moved about a mile down the road, and there was a bridge. The bridge was blown. But we were losing time. We've only moved about maybe 2 miles. My gut feeling was, there's no way we're going to get out of here. I mean, just no way.
We were trapped to follow the road because that's the only way we could rescue the wounded. We could have saved ourselves by abandoning the convoy. But to me, that was a coward's approach. We were morally bound.
We got up to Hill 1221, and another truck had gone into the ditch. And our driver pulled up behind them, shut the truck off, got out, and disappeared. Oh, I don't know if that truck was still operable or why he did that. But those two trucks were left there, filled with wounded. That's where I was captured.
All the soldiers there that were still alive became prisoners of war. But the rest of the convoy got through. We got down to where we hoped we'd meet up with the tanks, only to see them gone. Our hopes were dashed.
We thought we were on the goal line. He said, here's our goal post. I said, sorry about that, you're only on the 50-yard line. You got 4 more miles to go. So we were totally on our own, and that's when it all fell apart.
I flew up over the reservoir on the east side. I could see every movement on the ground. The Chinese were coming down the ridgeline and attacking this army unit on the road. And I watched them gradually being overwhelmed. I've been in World War II, I've seen all kinds of battles, but I'd never seen U.S. forces being destroyed like that.
We watched one truck on fire in which the wounded, their clothing on fire, screaming in agony. I never have felt so desperate in my life that I could do nothing about it.
Most of us have already calculated the situation. Well, we've done everything we can. It was like every man for himself at that point.
You would either become a captive, or you would try to save the men that were with you and get across the reservoir. We had a wild scramble across the ice. I lost my helmet in the panic. I lost my compass off of my pistol belt, and I fell down several times. My wounded thigh was just killing me. I told one of the guys, leave me here. I can't make it any further. I'm spent.
we got a call that, Doc, clear the deck. You've got multiple casualties coming in. And here come, over a period of about 3 days, several hundred Army casualties. And many of them had been out on the ice for 2 and 3 days. When they came in, these men were frozen, literally frozen.
Out of that 2,500 guys about that we had, I think that they got 385 guys back to the Marines that were fit to fight. That's a pretty high casualty rate.
When we finally walked in to Hagaree, we were like walking corpses from having been neglected for 5 days.
As the remains of the Army unit made it into Hagaree, the withdrawing Marine convoy west of the reservoir paused about 5 miles away. They rescued what was left of the single infantry company that had been holding the crucial pass above the road for the previous 5 days. Less than half the men at the pass were battle-ready. Nearly all were suffering frostbite or gnawing hunger. Bodies of dead Marines were stacked, frozen, between the aid tents.
And to bring all of our dead and our wounded that we could, that was just a Marine tradition. As long as we were able, we'd carry them with us.
Most of the wounded were able to walk, and those that couldn't walk rode on vehicles. They were piled up on trucks and on backs of tanks and on artillery pieces.
There was sniper fire, and walking alongside the convoy were troops. And when there wasn't any firing going on, they'd come and crawl around the Jeep, try to get warm. And if the convoy continued, we had to tell them, you know, you're going to have to walk again. And these poor guys maybe got 10, 15 minutes sleep, and then they were back up again.
We didn't have a chance to sleep, so you'd fall asleep walking. And there was no food, no water.
All of us kind of like in a daze because we were just kind of worn out, just completely exhausted.
The Chinese are constantly throwing up roadblocks, logs and rocks and boulders, anything to slow down the convoy so they can begin to attack them. Every twist and turn as they work their way south, they encounter something.
We were on the road there, and the whole column comes to a complete halt. I says, why is the column standing still? He says, we got prisoners all over the road. So I went up further, and right then and there, I lost it. I see these prisoners. They were done. They were out of it. They were shot up, and I didn't realize it. I took my M1 by the stack and swivel, and I started swinging at them, get off the road, get off the road, get out of the way, get going, move, move. And they would roll over, and these guys had no legs, no arms. Their bodies were blown apart. Their feet were black with frost. And I said to myself, oh, my God, what are you doing? You're a maniac. You're not the same person. You're a different person. You're just something you never thought you'd be.
Men inside the Hagaree garrison heard the rumble of trucks just before 7 o'clock on the evening of December 3rd, the end of the first full week of the battle. Then they spotted the lights at the head of the Marine convoy from Udemy, moving toward the northernmost checkpoint of the perimeter.
As we got near the lines, we were aware that we were getting into Hangaroo. Somebody said, count, cadence, count. And people started getting in step. You could hear the shoot backs. First, clumpity, clump, clumpity. And then there's clump, clump, clump. People were getting in step. We were marching.
We marched into Hangaroo. The sound of feet crunching in the frozen ice. Someone watching us said, look at those bastards, those magnificent bastards.
Somebody started singing the Marine Corps hymn. I couldn't believe it. They're singing the Marine Corps hymn. We're coming through the lines. And somebody handed me a canteen cup full of hot coffee and a box of graham crackers. And I just sat down in the snow and had probably the best meal I ever had in my life. That night I slept in my sleeping bag on the straw inside a tent. That was like luxury.
After the Marines' regiments had gotten back from west of the reservoir and consolidated there, there was a lot of correspondence there, too. Time Magazine, Life. They said, General, it's not like for Marines to retreat. Jim Smith told him, retreat hell. We're just advancing to the rear.
Smith bristled at the notion that this was a withdrawal or a retreat. There was no front. There was no rear. He was surrounded in all directions. Therefore, any movement in any direction is essentially an attack.
When General Smith insisted his men were not retreating, but attacking in another direction, at least one reporter in the camp suspected the bravado was masking a deep concern. As I looked at the battered men, she wrote, I wondered if they could possibly have the strength to make this final punch.
I cannot remember having a meal in Hangaroo. We were pretty short of everything. The worst part was the shoe packs, they call those rubber boots that came up about halfway to your knees. The bottom portion of them were rubber, and as long as you were moving, they worked good. But climbing those hills, your socks would get wet from sweat. And then you had no way to change the socks. So if you laid in the snow all night long, your feet would freeze.
The rubber boots had a belt insole about a half inch thick that was supposed to absorb perspiration. Instead, the insole would freeze, and it was like walking on ice.
I was thawing out, I guess, because they gave me some hot coffee and morphine. But they took my boots off, and I saw that my toes were black. And I sort of lost it. I wanted to cry. I didn't, but I wanted to cry. I said a few curse words. Somebody come over and says, knock it off. You act right. Act like a Marine. So I shut up.
My boot was frozen, so they had to chop the boot off. And part of my toes had came off inside the boot. And when they took the boot off, all the toes were gone. The tip of my toe was gone. That's big toe, little toe, and all through there. And three of them was found inside of that boot.
One of the miracles of Hangaroo and the Battle of Chosin is that they flew out 4,500 wounded. on C-47s. It's almost impossible.
Doctor has to certify that this patient is serious enough to be flown. So doctor's main job was actually dividing those who were to be sent with the airplane and those who were to be sent by a truck.
I remember vividly one man with part of his skull shot away. Brain was showing. Had we been in South Korea, or in other circumstances, he would have been sent to a hospital. And yes, he would be terribly injured, but he would have a chance of living. Here's another man who has a sucking chest wound. Got a bullet hole that's going through into his chest, and air is coming in and out. But we knew that this man would certainly live if we can get him to Japan. And he would go. And this other man put a dressing on it and give him morphine for pain and set him aside. And it's a morbid thought that we sent him aside to die, but we did. That's what we did.
There must have been 20 of us, maybe 30 of us on board. Then we flew for about an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours from Haguru to Japan. And when I got to Japan, then I felt, wow, I'm out of this war zone, and, I'm really going to be okay.
The air evacuation came to a close as the Marines prepared to abandon Haguru to the Chinese. The last flight out had room enough to carry letters from the surrounded Marines to anxious relatives back home, and to pack a handful of frozen corpses in among the casualties. But the question remained, how many of the 10,000 troops still at Haguru would make it out alive? As the Marines at Haguru braced for the next battle in their fight for survival, their head officer was in New York City, laying down a new marker in America's Cold War strategy. Idealism is fine, the Marine Commandant told a defense industry gathering. But if we are to assume leadership in a free world, we must have armed forces to make our will felt wherever our interest is threatened.
In the State Department and in the Department of Defense, what they are talking about is making the United States essentially in perpetuity the policeman of the world. Anywhere where communism is going to rear its head, we have to be ready to attack it.
President Truman was preparing to declare a national state of emergency to galvanize the country in an effort to roll back what he called communist imperialism. We had to get strong fast, said one of Truman's advisors, even if it meant giving up such things as refrigerators and television.
What the December 1950 crisis did was to convince the American people that they had to spend a lot more money and make a lot more sacrifices in a Cold War that had turned hot in Korea and might turn hot someplace else. And as a result of that, you had fundamental changes in American history. That built the national security state, built military bases abroad, a large standing army for the first time in U.S. history. And all of that transpired in December 1950, courtesy of the Chinese intervention.
On the morning of December 7th, as the rear guard dismantled the camp at Haguru, destroying supplies and equipment that would not fit on the trucks, the lead Marine units were already running the next gauntlet.
When we left Haguru, and were moving on toward Kotori. There were Chinese all over the side of the mountain. And I was standing up behind our Jeep trailer, which was all fully loaded, and I was standing up there firing my carbine, and the guy next to me got hit and went down.
One of the worst things of all is sitting on the lines and one of your fellow Marines is shot. And in his last dying breath, he's calling for his mother. And nothing is sadder or more heart-wrenching than hearing that.
One of the myths is that men don't cry. And that is bullshit. I saw people cry, especially when their friends got hit. When you're in pain, you cry.
You had a feeling of isolation. You didn't get too close to any other Marine because the death of a very close buddy would be devastating.
All of a sudden, it was automatic weapon fire coming out of this bunker. And so the Southern Marine and I crawled up the side of the hill to this bunker and threw in grenades. One guy, he was sitting in there with an automatic weapon, and one grenade landed right down in between his legs and that, and it blew his legs and his stomach was hanging off, but he was still alive. And he kept talking to me in Chinese, and I told the officer that was behind us, we got one left alive. And he says, well, you know what they did to us at East Hill. But as he was talking to me, and was he telling me about his family, was he pleading to me to dispatch him, and was he trying to save me, but he was going to die anyway. He was just all toward the people with that. With that, they dispatched him. I still think about him at night sometimes. Just wishing I could have understood what he was saying. It's nothing to kill him at a distance. It's when you look a man in the eye, that's different.
The cold had not let up in the 9 days since the battle began. Temperatures dropped as low as 30 below some nights, and rarely rose above zero, even when the sun was out. But Mao was still insisting that his army continue its mission, no matter the heavy losses to his troops. Nearly half the 60,000 Chinese soldiers facing the 1st Marines were already killed or wounded.
When they're coming at you, especially at night, you look at them as a superhuman. You feel like that there's nothing you can do to stop them, really. The people who wanted to surrender, it's just the opposite. They looked helpless, and they wanted help. They were starving.
The Chinese were sent into battle without proper clothing, without enough ammunition, without enough food, many of them. A lot of them had to just sort of fend for themselves, and many of them perished during the winter. We're talking about huge numbers that died not just of battle casualties, but by death by freezing.
On their feet, all they had was sneakers. You'd see a prisoner, and his feet was like a block of ice. I remember seeing a prisoner one time. His ears were swollen up this big, like a potato. You know, it looked like somebody the potato on the other side of his head that somebody had nicked with a knife. You know, they were bursting from having been frozen. They suffered terribly. A lot worse than we did.
I always remembered that no matter what the conditions were I was in, so were the Chinese. Up to this day, if I were to meet a Chinese soldier that was there, I'd hug him like a brother. Because I know he suffered the same thing I did.
By the time the head of the column reached Kotori, the Chinese were unable to mount any serious attack on the camp or to put up more than scattershot resistance on the road. But word was going through the ranks. Another obstacle lay ahead.
South of Kotori, several miles, is a pass called Funchalan Pass. And there's a bridge there. The Chinese had blown the bridge. We had to have a bridge put in. We had to have a way to cross that canyon. Otherwise, we wouldn't have got our vehicles out. We wouldn't have got our wounded out. It's a pretty desperate situation.
If memory serves me right, it was probably about a span of about 24 feet. And here we were with a big hole. We can't go nowhere.
While the column sat, waiting for the engineers to repair the breach, a front swept in from the north. Temperatures plummeted. Men who were there insisted it was near 50 below zero.
It goes from bad to worse. They go through everything they've been through and then now be facing a blizzard with this unbelievable cold.
When you're so damn cold, you really have trouble breathing, even. It is that cold. It was cold. Man, it was cold.
It is so cold that you just cannot function physically and mentally too. Cannot think of any complicated thing. You may not be able to even count 10. It's just brain just don't function.
One of the tricks I learned was to catch a nap by sitting on my helmet, which had a round bottom. And as I'd fall asleep, I'd fall over and wake up. But just before I'd fall asleep, I'd feel warm and total peace. And I think that's the way it feels just before you freeze to death.
I felt, how are we ever going to get out of here? There was a feeling, I had that, well, this could be it. I'll never get back to see my dear wife. And you just felt that, just a deep sense of helplessness and hopelessness.
At Kotori, the Marine commanders had to make choices about what they would be able to haul out on the remaining trucks and what they would have to leave behind.
They used some explosives to blast off the top part of the dirt. And then they could get a bulldozer blade in there, and they made a big hole.
they really had a difficult time because they had to blast and bulldoze a huge pit. And then Marines were dropped in.
They buried 117 right behind my howitzer. It was pretty devastating, pretty gruesome sight to look at.
One very close buddy, he was a Detroiter, and he was killed at UWNE. And I had the feeling that, you know, he and some others that I knew were being dropped into that hole.
Regimental Intelligence Officer Captain Donald France was one of them. His assistant, Lieutenant McGinnis, was one of them. And our driver, I think his name was Lundberg. He was one that they all put it in this hole and just covered it up. That's all the best we could do at that point.
The Marines at Cotoree were not alone in their misery. North Korean civilians had seen their homes destroyed by American bombers and artillery in the previous weeks, their winter food stores pillaged by starving Chinese soldiers. Scores of thousands were already fleeing south in hopes of finding warmth and safety. A growing number of refugees had trailed the column of retreating Marines all the way from UDAMNY.
They presented quite a challenge. You know, you can't tell if this person who's Asian in appearance is an enemy or not enemy. If they come into your lines, they had to be searched, you know, to make sure that there were no weapons and so on. So it was a challenge to accept them.
They didn't have food, and they didn't have near the gear that we had. I don't know how they were able to do it. I mean, it was heartbreaking. The kids crying and carrying on, and there's nothing you could really do for them.
What can you do? There's so many of them. All you can do is pray God that they fare well and make it through the day and the night and the next day and so forth, and until they get to a place where they can be safe.
I remember seeing old people, old women, old men, and there were reports of women even having babies out there in this sub-zero, 30 below zero or 40 below zero. At night, a moan would come up. And it was sort of a collective moan. The suffering that they went through.
The request was urgent and came from General Smith himself. So the Air Force agreed to undertake an operation never before attempted.
we had to get that bridge in, and I had a brilliant staff, and they decided that we could airdrop different parts of a Treadway bridge into the perimeter, bolt them together, and cantilever them over the gap where the bridge had been blown up by the Chinese, and we'd be able to evacuate.
Every steel girder required an entire plane to carry it, a C-119 boxcar, with two huge parachutes on both sides to drop it because they couldn't land.
Flying boxcars head for the area where the plight of the beleaguered troops has aroused the entire nation. Bridge sections to replace a crossing blasted by the Reds or parachuted to reopen the only escape route. This is the first time a bridge has ever been airdropped.
Early on the morning of December 9th, after nearly 3 days sitting at Cauderie, the Marines finally got the order to make their way toward the newly repaired bridge.
When we are walking, we feel we are surviving. So I guess we were able to resist the cold with the hope that this is the only way we can survive. All we have to just go a little more. That kind of sort of unconsciously hit your brain. Then you'll be able to follow the guy in the head of you.
We came down and walked along that single lane road with Chinese shooting at us, but we sort of ignored it. Every once in a while, you'd hear somebody yell out with a scream. You knew they got hit. But you just kept putting one foot ahead of the other. There was nothing you could do about it. There was nowhere to go, nowhere to hide, nowhere to take cover. And so you accepted your fate.
Wondered how that first driver felt when he pulled over on that bridge, if it was going to hold him or not.
Nothing like this had ever been tried before. No one was sure it was going to work. And it was a very, very scary couple of minutes until the first few vehicles passed over. And the men who marched across could look down through the gap and see 500 feet, 1,000 feet down into the valley.
As I reached the bridge, there was a man standing there saying, "Walk across this side." And I knew then that I was glad it wasn't daylight because I couldn't see down what I was going over.
I don't have any direct memories of even walking across that span. By that time, my brain was frozen. All I knew is, don't stop.
There was this truck on the side of the road with some guys on it. They were wounded. And he said, "Can you drive a truck?" I said, "Sure, I can drive a truck." So I actually drove a truck across that chasm with wounded guys back there and the Chinese trying to kill the drivers. But I thought, once we get across this bridge, we're home. We've got it made.
It took almost 2 days to move the 14,000 surviving troops, along with trucks, tanks, and artillery pieces, over the makeshift bridge. The last of the Marines and the attached Army units made it across late on December 11, 1950, 2 weeks to the day after the initial Chinese attack.
Coming down into the flatter land off of the mountains, it got warmer. It was 32 degrees, we were taking off clothes. It was hot for us. There's a feeling of elation that you don't have anybody that's shooting at you anymore. You're not shooting back. And just a full relax. Happy to be alive.
When we got to the bottom of the pass, our column was halted. And when we stopped, we just fell to the side of the road and just laid back and went dead asleep. We were so exhausted, we didn't have much left. We were out of there in time. Just in time.
On the 27th of November at 9:45, that's when the Chinese hit us. And every year on 27th November, I take a walk up on a hill. And I sit down. I just thank God for letting me survive that. And I pray about the other fellows that we've lost.
It's a testimony to the Marines that so many of them survived it and managed to fight their way out. But fundamentally, it was a Chinese victory that was a key battle in clearing North Korea of UN forces, and they've never been back.
The Chinese forced the Americans from the field, but they suffered staggering casualties. Mao threw everything he had at the Marines, and they eluded his grasp.
When we got down off the plateau into the seacoast there, the Chinese never threatened us. We were able to get 90,000 civilians out, North Korean civilians. The Chinese never stopped them, never made any threat.
I still believe that the sacrifice, not only of the Marines, but the Army and Navy and everybody that supported that engagement did the right thing. South Korea is still alive, and they're proud people, hardworking people, and I support them to this day. And I don't begrudge a second of the time I spent over there in their defense. Not at all.
They used to say that it's a forgotten war. I have to say it's a winning war. We didn't win it in the sense of reuniting North and South Korea. That didn't happen. But we were able to maintain South Korea as a viable country. and what we were able to maintain was worth the fighting, worth every bit of it. And I'm proud to have been part of that.
When I talk to people about the Children of Reservoir, I'll tell people I'm one of the survivors. I'm grateful that I was able to get out there with no more than a little arthritis and loss of foot. I am proud of this because I was part of history.
It was something that has stayed with me my entire adult life. I didn't realize what an impact that experience would have on my soul, on my being. I fought in many other battles after that. Nothing to compare with the Battle of the Chosen Reservoir.
Coming to American Experience.
The warhead on top of the Titan II was three times as powerful as all the bombs used in the Second World War.
Working on a weapon of mass destruction, you're counting on everything to work perfect all the time, and things just don't work perfect all the time.
Command and Control, coming to American Experience. American Experience, The Battle of Chosin, is available on DVD. To order, visit shoppbs.org or call 1-800-PLAY-PBS. American Experience is also available for download on iTunes.
The Chinese used a night cover to camouflage their movements, and they were moving away from the roads, hidden at night from our aircraft surveillance, and also in the daytime by staying within the forest under the trees.
They moved at night and they stayed up on the ridgelines. The U.S. forces in general stayed on the roads and went hell-bent for the border. But meanwhile, in between the forces, Chinese were coming quietly down on foot.
Mao knew his military was far inferior to the Americans in tanks, artillery, and air power. But he had taken the measure of MacArthur and discerned a weakness. In early November, Mao sent small cadres of troops to attack all along the approaching American front. Then his men pulled back.
From us maybe 5-10 yards that way. So my rifle jams now. And this guy throws a hand grenade over. I took one step and the hand grenade went off. I feel myself flying through the air, but I don't feel myself hit the ground.
I think it was a mortar that hit right in the hole, and I flew up out in the air and landed on the ground. And I looked around and I said, hey, them poor guys lost the leg. And I got up and I fell flat on my face. And I looked down and it was that leg laying over there, and that poor guy was me. It was my right leg was gone at the knee.
I remember my mother waving to us. But then later on I realized that she really wasn't waving. She was giving us her blessing as we drove by.
By the time the first big wave of reserves arrived, the North Korean army had nearly pushed U.S. troops off the peninsula. But Douglas MacArthur remained confident he could reverse the losses. He ordered his forces to attack deep into enemy-held territory
at the port of Incheon.
MacArthur took the chance and tried to conduct a landing there at high tide, which only had a range of a few hours to debark troops there. And also, it wasn't a good beach at all. There's a seawall there. But the enemy didn't expect us to land there. So it became a tremendous surprise to the enemy. And it wasn't very well defended.
But climbing those hills, your socks would get wet from sweat. And then you had no way to change the socks. So if you laid in the snow all night long, your feet would freeze.
The rubber boots had a belt insole about a half inch thick that was supposed to absorb perspiration. Instead, the insole would freeze and it was like walking on ice.
I was thawing out, I guess, because they gave me some hot coffee and morphine. But they took my boots off and I saw that my toes were black. And I sort of lost it. I wanted to cry. I didn't, but I wanted to cry. I said a few curse words. Somebody come over and says, "Knock it off. You act right. Act like a Marine." So I shut up.
My boot was frozen. It captured Seoul, the capital of the South, in less than 72 hours and kept going, making plain its goal to take the entire peninsula.
When the North Koreans invaded, they had Soviet equipment, they had Soviet tanks, they had Soviet advisors. The American people believed that what was happening is that it was Stalin's proxy war against the United States.
On hearing the grave news, President Truman flies to Washington from his Missouri home. The president described the invasion as a threat to the peace which cannot be tolerated.
This is a direct challenge to the efforts of free nations to build the kind of world in which men can live in freedom and peace. This challenge has been presented squarely. We must meet it squarely.
Within days of the invasion, the United Nations Security Council resolved to repel the North Koreans from the South and to...
Cranberries, the whole works.
It was cold turkey, let me tell you. The cooks did the best they could. But it was Thanksgiving, and we did have optimism that the war would be over, and maybe that's thanks in itself.
The commander of the UN forces, General Douglas MacArthur, flew into Korea the next day to launch the final offensive of what was shaping up to be a short and successful war.
MacArthur tells the troops and his commanders that the fundamental goal of the Korean War, to unify the peninsula under the control of the South Korean government, will soon be accomplished. And he says to the soldiers, "I hope you boys will be home by Christmas."
The northern boundary of North Korea is the Yalu River. And so his cry became that he wanted to go to the Yalu and conquer all of North Korea. They were just going to go up the mountain, just like cutting through butter, and they were going to go to the Yalu, and it was going to be great.
I was really excited about it. I thought, boy, this is what we should do. And I thought that, you know, it was in the bag.
Every newspaper and every magazine was just full of the news. My wife didn't know anything about the details of it, but the headlines were big and broad. 31st Infantry annihilated.
My father kept a collection of newspaper clippings and his stories that Marine Corps has been annihilated. It's a lost legion. Marine Corps trapped. They're isolated. The papers had given up on us.
My wife had lost a brother aboard the USS Arizona at Pearl Harbor, and she was thinking that she might lose me.
The crossroads town had to be held if there was to be any hope of extracting his endangered men.
Hagaru was very thinly defended. There really weren't very many combat troops there at all. General Smith had cooks and bakers and PX people, and he had the engineers that were building the field. It was a really motley crew.
While American fighter planes kept the Chinese pinned down, Smith pushed his engineers to finish construction of the airstrip so pilots could fly in reinforcements. And he deployed almost every man at his disposal to defend the perimeter of Hagaru, many at a spot called East Hill, the high ground that rose above the ammunition dump.
Ammunitions are coming, they just drop. Every hour they just drop and drop, drop. It was my job to get the supply by airdrops. The Chinese start to fire at us when we are picking up the
thing. We were kids just out of high school and all wanted to be a Marine. A gung-ho Marine. Carry a rifle, shoot at somebody.
I remember getting on the train and we pulled out. I remember my mother waving to us. But then later on I realized that she really wasn't waving. She was giving us her blessing as we drove by.
By the time the first big wave of reserves arrived, the North Korean army had nearly pushed U.S. troops off the peninsula. But Douglas MacArthur remained confident he could reverse the losses. He ordered his forces to attack deep into enemy-held territory at the port of Incheon.
MacArthur took the chance and tried to conduct a landing there.
He ordered his forces to attack deep into enemy-held territory at the port of Incheon.
MacArthur took the chance and tried to conduct a landing there at high tide, which only had a range of a few hours to debark troops there. And also, it wasn't a good beach at all. There's a seawall there. But the enemy didn't expect us to land there. So it became a tremendous surprise to the enemy. And it wasn't very well defended. Success at Incheon was a bold stroke of genius.
On 16 September, the 1st Marine Division moves through Incheon. This city is recaptured against relatively light resistance. Allied casualties are few. As these men move through Incheon, their objective is Seoul.
5 o'clock on November 28th. The men dug in to hold East Hill could see the engineers at work under floodlights, racing to finish the airstrip below. A light snow began to fall at around 8 o'clock. And for the next few hours, all was quiet, but for the scrape and roar of the bulldozers. Just after 10:30, the calm broke.
The Chinese recognized the fact that East Hill was the key. So they really concentrated it that night. We were at the bottom to halfway up the hill, and not with infantry. We had engineers, artillerymen, cooks and bakers, whoever we could gather. You have to do it. You have to hold it.
My boot was frozen, so they had to chop the boot off, and part of my toes had came off inside the boot. And when they took the boot off, all the toes were gone. The tip of my toe was gone. That's big toe, little toe, and all through there. And three of them was found inside of that boot.
One of the miracles of Hagaru and the Battle of Chosin is that they flew out 4,500 wounded on C-47s
It's almost impossible. It started out well, but it took time. And then we ran into a lot of machine gun mortar, heavy mortar fire, and we got bogged down. We got wounded and dead Marines you're putting on trucks. Trucks are being blowed up, they're being shot up. As each truck stopped, the men on that truck had to protect that truck. That was their war. You didn't know what was happening, two trucks in front of you or two trucks behind you.
The Chinese cut off and destroyed the middle of Drysdale's convoy. The men at the rear turned and fought their way back to Koto Ree. Drysdale radioed Smith to report the unfolding disaster.
When Drysdale called General Smith, he wanted to know if he should turn around and go back to Koto Ree. General Smith knew that he had to have these reinforcements.
Little regard for their own safety.
The only way they could overwhelm us was with sheer force of numbers. First wave would all have weapons. The second wave wouldn't all have weapons. They would pick up weapons of the first wave. And the third wave would be commissars with burp guns. Nobody retreats.
Smith's men were hugely outnumbered. The Chinese divisions were coming in from all sides. Smith was really doubtful whether Hagaru could actually hold.
While the makeshift unit struggled to hold Hagaru, their fellow Marines west of the reservoir were preparing for a second night of attack.
I had no idea what was coming. I knew it'd be bad, and I hope I can do.
Mao knew his military was far inferior to the Americans in tanks, artillery, and air power. But he had taken the measure of MacArthur and discerned a weakness. In early November, Mao sent small cadres of troops to attack all along the approaching American front. Then his men pulled back in what looked like a full retreat.
The Chinese hit hard. Then they just disappeared. There was nothing out there anymore. MacArthur said full speed ahead again.
This became part of the strategy, which is to lure the Americans further into North Korea, have them penetrate deeply, and then ultimately surround them. There's a certain shrewdness about Mao. He knows who he's dealing with. He knows that MacArthur is quite arrogant. This is a strategy that plays into that arrogance.
American people believed that what was happening is that it was Stalin's proxy war against the United States.
On hearing the grave news, President Truman flies to Washington from his Missouri home. The president described the invasion as a threat to the peace which cannot be tolerated.
This is a direct challenge to the efforts of free nations to build the kind of world in which men can live in freedom and peace. This challenge has been presented squarely. We must meet it squarely.
Within days of the invasion, the United Nations Security Council resolved to repel the North Koreans from the south and to restore peace and security in the area. The United States was to lead a multinational force tasked with enforcing the UN resolution.
I was 20 years old when the war broke out. I knew very little about Korea, but I knew we were in direct conflict. But you just kept putting one foot ahead of the other. There was nothing you could do about it. There was nowhere to go, nowhere to hide, nowhere to take cover. And so you accepted your fate.
I always wondered how that first driver felt when he pulled over on that bridge, if it was going to hold him or not.
Nothing like this had ever been tried before. No one was sure it was going to work. And it was a very, very scary couple of minutes until the first few vehicles passed over.
They buried 117 right behind my howitzer. It was pretty devastating, pretty gruesome sight to look at.
One very close buddy was a Detroiter, and he was killed at UWE. And I had the feeling that, you know, he and some others that I knew were being dropped into that hole.
Regimental intelligence officer Captain Donald France was one of them. His assistant
fell down a road and there was a bridge. The bridge was blown. But we were losing time. We've only moved about maybe 2 miles. My gut feeling was, there's no way we're going to get out of here. I mean, just no way.
We were trapped to follow the road because that's the only way we could rescue the wounded. We could have saved ourselves by abandoning the convoy. But to me, that was a coward's approach. We were morally bound.
We got up to Hill 1221, and another truck had gone into the ditch. And our driver pulled up behind them, shut the truck off, got out, and disappeared. Now, I don't know if that truck was still operable or why he did that. But those two trucks were left there, filled with wounded. That's where I was captured.
Well, the soldier.
One very close buddy was a Detroiter, and he was killed at UWE. And I had the feeling that, you know, he and some others that I knew were being dropped into that hole.
Regimental intelligence officer Captain Donald France was one of them. His assistant, Lieutenant McGinnis, was one of them. And our driver, I think his name was Lundberg, he was one that they all put it in this hole and just covered it up as all the best we could do at that point.
We were saved. It's nothing to kill them at a distance. It's when you look a man in the eye, that's different.
Cold had not let up in the 9 days since the battle began. Temperatures dropped as low as 30 below some nights, and rarely rose above zero, even when the sun was out. But Mao was still insisting that his army continue its mission, no matter the heavy losses to his troops. Nearly half the 60,000 Chinese soldiers facing the 1st Marines were already killed or wounded.
When they're coming at you, especially at night, you look at them as a superhuman.
We knew that our tank company had been at Hudong Ni, And we'd hoped maybe if we could join up with the tanks, with their firepower, that then we would be escorted in safely to the Marines' aggregate.
Once we get back to the tank, we got it made. We're home free. We got supplies back there and everything.
We had 400 to 450 wounded that had to be carried by truck. And the only way we could load them was to triple deck them. We stacked layers of wounded in the trucks.
The dead you had to leave. You had to stack them on a pile. We had to leave them.
We had to strip the dead of their clothing in order to provide some warmth for those wounded on the trucks.
Supply route, nearly 80 miles long, leading to the Chosin Reservoir. 3,600 men were making camp at the bottom of the reservoir at Hagaruri, where division headquarters and a much-needed airfield were taking shape. 5 miles ahead, on the west side of the reservoir, was a small contingent of 400 Marines, defending the high ground above the road. The bulk of the forces, 8,000 Marines, were digging in near the village of Udamni, preparing to spearhead the next day's offensive. To the east were 2,500 U.S. Army soldiers and several hundred South Korean fighters, placed there to protect the right flank of the attacking Marines. As darkness fell on November 27th, the men on both sides of the reservoir were settling in for their last night of sleep before their big attack to the Yalu.
I remember my mother waving to us. But then later on I realized that she really wasn't waving. She was giving us her blessing as we drove by.
By the time the first big wave of reserves arrived, the North Korean army had nearly pushed U.S. troops off the peninsula. But Douglas MacArthur remained confident he could reverse the losses. He ordered his forces to attack deep into enemy-held territory at the port of Incheon.
MacArthur took the chance and tried to conduct a landing there at high tide, but you only had a range of a few hours to debark troops there. And also, it wasn't a good beach at all. There's a seawall there. But the enemy didn't expect us to land there. So it became a tremendous surprise to the enemy. And it wasn't very well defended.
Of the first wave. And the third wave would be commissars with burp guns. Nobody retreats.
Smith's men were hugely outnumbered. The Chinese divisions were coming in from all sides. Smith was really doubtful whether Hagaru could actually hold.
While the makeshift unit struggled to hold Hagaru, their fellow Marines west of the reservoir were preparing for a second night of attack.
I had no idea what was coming. I knew it'd be bad, and I hope I can do what I'm supposed to do and don't let anybody down.
You learn to control your emotions. You pledge yourself to fight for your buddy, and he has the same to fight for me.
Brain was frozen. All I knew is don't stop.
There was this truck on the side of the road with some guys on it. They were wounded. And he said, can you drive a truck? I said, sure, I can drive a truck. So I actually drove a truck across that chasm with wounded guys back there and the Chinese trying to kill the drivers. But I thought, once we get across this bridge, we're home. We've got it made.
It took almost 2 days to move the
forge approach. We were morally bound.
We got up to Hill 1221, and another truck had gone into the ditch. And our driver pulled up behind them, shut the truck off, got out, and disappeared. Oh, I don't know if that truck was still operable or why he did that. But those two trucks were left there, filled with wounded. That's where I was captured.
All the soldiers there that were still alive became prisoners of war. But the rest of the convoy got through. We got down to where we hoped we'd meet up with the tanks, only to see them gone. Our hopes were dashed.
We thought we were on the goal line. He said, here's our goal post.
I said, with close air support, with artillery, with getting the casualties out at the right moment, it's a very, very complex operation.
The division was getting geared up. They were burning a lot of things. They were getting rid of a lot of weapons, things that weren't usable. And we were going to start our way back south.
On December 1st, after four long nights of fighting off enemy attacks, the 1st Marines on the west side of the reservoir began their perilous journey.
You only had one road, one point of entry and egress on each side of the reservoir and up to the reservoir. Dirt road, flanked by hills on either side. A nightmare, absolute nightmare.
Mao thought that if he could destroy the 1st Marine Division, this would create great fear and doubt in Washington and cause the war to end quickly. His goal—
because we thought help was on its way. Here was our division commander. He's showing concern. Here he was. That means help must be on its way. But that wasn't the message.
The general said, you're going to get no help. We had to fight our own way out.
By the time General Douglas MacArthur left his headquarters in Tokyo to reckon the damage, he appeared to have lost his characteristic self-confidence.
It must have just shaken him right down to the ground to have this happen. It just was not in his game plan. I don't think he could understand it.
The Chinese had redrawn the battle map in less than 72 hours. MacArthur's army in the west of Korea was in headlong retreat, having abandoned supplies and weapons to Mao's forces.
You'll be able to follow the guy in the head of you.
We came down and walked along that single-lane road with Chinese shooting at us, but we sort of ignored it. Every once in a while, you'd hear somebody yell out with a scream. You knew they got hit. But you just kept putting one foot ahead of the other. There was nothing you could do about it. There was nowhere to go, nowhere to hide, nowhere to take cover. And so you accepted your fate.
Always wondered how that first driver felt when he pulled over on that bridge, if it was going to hold him or not.
Nothing like this had ever been tried before. No one was sure it was going to work. And it was very, very scary couple of minutes until the first few vehicles passed over. And the men who marched across looked down through the gap and see 500 feet, 1,000 feet down into the valley.
As I reached the bridge, there was a man standing there saying, "Walk across this side." And I knew then that I was glad it wasn't daylight because I couldn't see down what I was going over.
I don't have any direct memories of even walking across that span. By that time, my brain was frozen. All I knew is, don't stop.
There was this truck on the side of the road with some guys on it. They were wounded. And he said, "Can you drive a truck?" I said, "Sure, I can drive a truck." So I actually drove a truck across that chasm with wounded guys back there and the Chinese trying to kill the drivers. But I thought, once we get across this bridge, we're home. We've got it made.
It took almost 2 days to move the 14,000 surviving troops, along with trucks, tanks, and artillery pieces, over the makeshift bridge. The last of the Marines and the attached Army units made it across late on December 11, 1950, 2 weeks to the day after the initial Chinese attack.
Coming down into the flatter land off of the mountains, it got warmer. It was 32 degrees, we were taking off clothes. It was hot for us. There's a feeling of elation that you don't have anybody that's shooting at you anymore. You're not shooting back. And just a full relax. Happy to be alive.
When we got to the bottom of the pass, our column was halted. And when we stopped, we just fell to the side of the road and just laid back and went dead asleep. We were so exhausted, we didn't have much left. We were out of there in time. Just in time.
On the 27th of November at 9:45, that's when the Chinese hit us. And every year on 27th of November, I take a walk up on a hill. And I sit down. I just thank God for letting me survive that. And I pray about the other fellows that we've lost.
It's a testimony to the Marines that so many of them survived it and managed to fight their way out. But fundamentally, it was a Chinese victory that was a key battle in clearing North Korea of UN forces, and they've never been back.
the Chinese forced the Americans from the field. But they suffered staggering casualties. Mao threw everything he had at the Marines, and they eluded his grasp.
When we got down off the plateau into the seacoast there, the Chinese never threatened us. We were able to get 90,000 civilians out, North Korean civilians. The Chinese never stopped them, never made any threat.
I still believe that the sacrifice, not only of the Marines, but the Army and Navy and everybody that supported that engagement did the right thing. South Korea is still alive, and they're proud people, hardworking people, and I support them to this day. And I don't begrudge a second of the time I spent over there in their defense. Not at all.
They used to say that it's a forgotten war. I have to say it's a winning war. We didn't win it in the sense of reuniting North and South Korea. That didn't happen. But we were able to maintain South Korea as a viable country. And what we were able to maintain was worth the fighting, worth every bit of it. And I'm proud to have been part of that.
When I talk to people about the children of the war, I'll tell people I'm one of the survivors. I'm grateful that I was able to get out there with no more than a little arthritis and loss of foot. I am proud of this because I was part of history.
It was something that has stayed with me my entire adult life. I didn't realize what an impact that experience would have on my soul, on my being. I fought in many other battles after that. Nothing to compare with the Battle of the Chosin Reservoir.
American experience.
The warhead on top of the Titan II was three times as powerful as all the bombs used in the Second World War.
Working on a weapon of mass destruction, you're counting on everything to work perfect all the time, and things just don't work perfect all the time.
Command and Control, coming to American Experience. American Experience, The Battle of Chosin, is available on DVD. To order, visit shoppbs.org or call 1-800-PLAY-PBS. American Experience is also available for download on iTunes.